Morning. This is Bill Scher on the Liberal Oasis Radio Show. Great to be with you on another Saturday. I believe this is the final day of the Winter Valley Market over at Enterprise Farm, 71 River Road in Waitley. I believe there is much festivities going on starting right now at 10 a.m. going through 3 p.m. We're at the end of another week of this interminable campaign. Clinton fans are rejoicing, no question. Obama fans are not. The rest of the country, I think, just wants the show to be over. But in my mind, not that much has really changed here as far as questions or arguments about the two candidates' electability is concerned. There's obviously great focus on Obama's electability, great attention on can he win the votes of older white working class voters, particularly women, therefore there's that is fueling the Clinton argument, saying, "Hey, he's not been fully vetted yet. Doesn't matter that he has more delegates. Doesn't matter that he is ahead in the polls among Democrats. We got to think about the general election here." But in my mind, this is not new information. Obama has, over the course of this campaign, a relative weakness. It's not a shutout, but it's a relative weakness amongst these older white working class voters. But Clinton has a relative weakness when it comes to independent voters and Republican moderates, which Obama has had greater ability to bring into the fold. Pennsylvania was a state where independents and registered Republicans were not allowed to vote. So his relative strength couldn't play at a higher degree. He tried to get as many of those folks registered as Democrats ahead of time, and he actually had great success in that. He got roughly 185,000 new voters to the polls. They're about 280,000 total, and Obama won them by a 60%, 62% margin. But that was not enough in a state where that was a relatively older state, and those working class voters definitely broke Clinton's way. But you go to other states, Obama's consistently done better with those independents and moderate Republicans who are obviously going to vote. You know, all those, every demographic is going to vote, you know, come the general. So that doesn't really change things to me. And of course, and in all this discussion about Clinton and Obama's weaknesses, we're not necessarily talking about McCain's weaknesses. Everybody's got weaknesses here. The question then becomes, can you make a definitive argument whose weakness is the bigger problem? And quite frankly, that's not something that anyone can do definitively. It's all subjective here. I would suspect in the end that it all comes down to superdelegates, as we know. Neither candidate is going to be able to get enough pledged delegates out of the primary and caucus process to lock this down without the help of superdelegates the way the Democratic rules are structured. Obama's going to have more, we know that, but it's not going to be enough. For the superdelegates to go against the delegate lead and risk a huge backlash amongst Obama supporters that could be greatly detrimental in a general election, they're going to need a really airtight, rock-solid argument. I would suspect Obama's going to have to be polling demonstrably worse versus McCain vis-a-vis Clinton for the superdelegates to make that kind of jump. You have not seen that in general election polling. I think generally they're polling roughly the same. I think there are more where Obama's a touch ahead. I know there's at least one where Clinton's a touch ahead, but it's all really in the ballpark. And that is going to be a very hard jump for superdelegates to make unless that changes in some way. So I don't think all that much has really changed as far as how this election is going forward. We're going to talk more about presidential politics after the break with author Cliff Schechter, author of the controversial new expose, The Real McCain. But one of the things I like to do on this show is help us all counter the media narratives that get shaped by the conservative machine, often by the neoconservative machine when it comes to foreign policy. You may be hearing a lot of news about how there is new evidence that the North Koreans were helping the Syrians build a nuclear reactor for weapons production. This was a facility that the Israeli military had taken out in an airstrike back in September. Lots of murkiness about what was really going on there. So they put out this new video showing their photographic evidence, such as it is, and the media is generally accepting it at face value. I cannot tell you definitively what's going on. I can tell you there are other interpretations of what is going on that is at least worth processing. For example, the French wire agency, Agence French Presse, that is their associated press, they had pointed out, and of course I think there are U.S. sources that have said the same, quote, they said the U.S. intelligence had high confidence that the structure bombed by the Israelis was a nuclear reactor, medium confidence that the North Koreans were involved in building it, and low confidence that the plutonium from it was for nuclear weapons. Because other elements of a weapons program, such as a plutonium reprocessing plant, had not been detected, the U.S. intelligence was less certain that the plutonium was for nuclear weapons. Now, low confidence in the definition of our intelligence community means, low confidence means that the information's credibility and or plausibility is questionable, or that the information is too fragmented or poorly corroborated to make solid analytic inferences, or that we have significant concerns or problems with the sources. So that is really the key point here. Is this a weapons facility or not? And that is what they have their lowest confidence about. Keep in mind that they had high confidence that the Iranians had suspended their weapons program in 2003. Yet, of course, you still see great saber rattling amongst the Bush administration with Iran. They have not really taken their own intelligence community's evidence to heart. Whereas, obviously, when there is low confidence in this case of this North Korean Syria speculation, that doesn't seem to be factoring in. There's also a question about the timing of the release of this evidence. Arms Control Wonk, which is a great blog, says, prima facie, it makes no sense. The U.S. administration commits to a deal with the North Koreans under which North Korea is not yet required to declare its assistance to Syria if it indeed occurred. This was actually a point of discussion in its negotiations with the U.S. and North Korea, whether or not they would have a deal to get their weapons facility, get their nuclear facilities inspected again. So Arms Control Wonk says, why encourage opposition to the deal within the U.S. by showing evidence of said assistance? I can see three possible reasons, not mutually exclusive, none of which I can find entirely satisfactory. The first one is, elements within the U.S. administration opposed to the deal have convinced the president that this evidence ought to be shown in an effort to wreck the deal. Now, this is something that's getting a fair amount of attention. Arms Control Wonk is a little skeptical, saying, I have slightly a hard time believing this is because it seems the negotiator had achieved buy-in for the deal at the very highest levels. But presumably there is still some strong opposition, and such a messy bureaucratic compromise would hardly be unprecedented. That, to me, strikes me as particularly suspicious. Josh Landis over at Syria Comment notes that at the same time this information is coming out, the BBC and Bloomberg are running stories explaining that Israel is willing to return the Golan Heights to Syria. The point of the story is not that real peace talks are going on between Israel and Syria, but that Israeli Prime Minister Olmert has evidently told Turkey's Prime Minister that in a future agreement, Israel would be willing to relinquish the entire Golan. He is making an implication that perhaps this is coming out to upend any possibility of that going forward. So there's a lot of pieces here that are at play, and we should not be quick to judge what's going on based on pieces of information that have been selectively provided to us by the administration. And let's not even forget that. Let's even say this is all true. Let's presume that North Korea did help Syria try to build a weapons facility, or even as a nuclear reactor that had no weapons component to it. It's still highly questionable how this was handled, if it makes sense for Israel to simply strike at it militarily instead of simply bringing the information to the UN's International Atomic Energy Association to be investigated. It's still only questions. It does not necessarily mean that the North Korea deal should be scrapped, or perhaps that simply we should be incorporating this information and getting a stronger deal. All sorts of ways you can analyze this. We do not have to simply accept the neocon narrative for this. We should be getting out there, getting as much information from we can from other sources that are not so easily manipulated by the administration, and make our own judgments. When we come back, we'll be talking to Cliff Schechter, author of The Real McCain, hot new controversial expose. This is Bill Scherer for the Liberal Oasis radio show. Back after this.